It's a great pleasure to be asked to give this lecture that was established in honor of Shirley Baker, because I remember very well when I first met Shirley and when I worked at the Association of Research Libraries, and it was only a year after she first came to Washington University, and she was leading a very intensive project to study the costs of interlibrary loan. All these years later, we're still agonizing about that. It's just gotten even more complicated. We are, at my library, in the middle of complaining to all our national vendors about how bad the interlibrary loan systems interoperate. But I remember Shirley writing this great white paper with the Association of Research Libraries. So, you know, plus à chance, as they say. I wanted to talk about this topic partly because I was asked on fairly short notice, could I come? And I said, only if I can, you know, offer you up a couple of things I already know what to talk about. But this one I think is especially perfect because it's very relevant to what might be possible here in St. Louis. And when we started working on this in Chicago, only Philadelphia had done something like this. And you'll see as I explain it, it seems like common sense, but you know, why didn't we do it before? And it's really a very simple concept about linking the stuff we already have. And big city history is a phrase I sort of was thinking about this topic. It's big history, but it's more about big city. And how do you make that happen? And you'll see in a moment, the people who came together were institutions that have been around for 150 years. So these are not new institutions. These are not new materials, but this is a whole new way of organizing that none of us had ever tried before. And the bridging of institutional boundaries is very challenging, but very essential. And as academic libraries, we get in our own silos. We talk about collaboration constantly, but it's really with other libraries like us. And even that like us, it's not even other academic libraries. It's only certain academic libraries, whoever we think is good enough. You know, we don't mess with that other category of academic libraries. And we only collaborate with public libraries if they happen to be next door, so we're going to have a shuttle going back and forth. But even that is very rare. And in fact, the opportunity to come together around a major metropolitan area that has a lot of longstanding cultural heritage institutions is quite fantastic. And it's tricky, which is probably why it hasn't been done very often, but it's very doable. And the reason it's doable is because when you start talking to each other, you realize everybody wants the same thing. Everybody loves the place. This is very much about how a place can inspire. And a city with a heritage like Chicago, a city with a heritage like Philadelphia, you can exactly imagine the same thing in St. Louis. A city with a heritage and a lot of institutions that want to preserve that motivates people to say, you know, how can we bring this together and make it better, not just for our own institutions, but for the city as a whole. And this mission we came to, of course, through the usual difficulty of how do you frame a mission statement and all kinds of wordsmithing for weeks. But in fact, the core of the mission was already there. We already had this instinct that this was what it was about. And it sort of started by accident. So by coincidence, it began in 2006, which was the year I actually came to Northwestern. Where, by the way, when I announced to people in Santa Barbara, when I announced to people in Santa Barbara that I was leaving to move to Chicago, they thought I was completely crazy. And I said, but it's, you know, a bigger library and a better salary and it's closer to my family. And it's like, but no, the weather is better here. You have to stay. Because really, when you live in Santa Barbara, as Denise will tell you, all that matters is how, I mean, the weather is beautiful, but there are other life goals. So I came in 2006. And right away, of course, you're making the rounds of the other deans and vice presidents. And the now retired president's wife, who was a very well-known scholar of legal history, took me out to lunch, a big library user. She wanted to like get to know the new kid. And I swear the first thing she said to me is, why aren't we participating in the Festival of Maps? I had no idea what she was talking about. And I was like, well, I guess I better find out. So I went back to the library. I said, what is this festival of maps? And I got us into that right away. And it turned out this was something that started very small. The Newbury Library and the Field Museum, which have incredible collections of rare maps, were one of them started an exhibit and the other joined in. I don't know exactly how that original pair of exhibition, but even before the exhibition itself came to fruition, they had roped in a series of other partners. And it became a citywide federated sort of event, multiple locations over a series of months with a really cool website that, you know, had a lot of GIS embedded so you could look at locations and get pop-ups of what were the different exhibitions. And different institutions all over the city got into this, you know, who had maps or place-specific things or avant-garde art that was inspired by maps and things like this. And we had so much fun working on it, and we had multiple meetings downtown with representatives from the participants in the Festival of Maps. It was like, you know, gee, we should do this more often, you know. And we realized, of course, nobody had a clue what each other had. I mean, except in very large scale. Like, we sort of knew big collection XYZ at the Newbury, collection ABC at University of Chicago, people associated one or two specialties per institution in Chicago. But there was actually no reliable database that connected, even of people's cataloged material, let alone, of course, uncataloged material. And so we started to think, well, let's have a little spreadsheet, literally Excel spreadsheet. Let's get the curators together and list what we have. And we started calling this the Chicago Library Collaborative so we could find a way to keep meeting because it was fun. The best anecdote that I came into this anecdote after the fact, so I don't know about whom it was told, but it is true. Over the course of the Festival of Maps and the Chicago Library Collaborative, two of the founding partners discovered they had opposite halves of the same manuscript letter correspondence collection and had had those two halves for years and years, and neither one knew it. So there's a lot of hidden wealth in a city's cultural heritage institutions. So we started getting much more intentional about working on this and realized that what we wanted to do was have a web portal. Now, our vision evolved quite a bit. Originally, it was just like, well, let's have a web page where we list, you know, we load up this Excel spreadsheet. So obviously, it got a little more sophisticated following that. But we needed funding. So we decided we'd apply for a grant, and that took us several years. So in between, as you can see, 2007 and 2011. And it was hard, and you had to have different, this was all on volunteer time. Mary Case, who is currently the president of the Association of Research Libraries, led the grant-seeking initiative, and it was just yeoman labor for years. And a certain agency will tell you, oh, we'd love a proposal from you, and then they turn you down. So then you go back to square one. We did get it from the Mellon Foundation, which already had funded several of our partner institutions, so we already were familiar with the program officers and the goals of the Mellon Foundation. And this was a two-part planning grant because the Mellon Foundation's very concerned about sustainability. They don't want to give you money and then you build something and then it just goes away. So the planning grant was to look at how to build an organization and then what kind of technology might be appropriate to link our collections. So it was kind of on parallel paths from the beginning, the organizational nature of what we were going to be, and then the technology. So that required a lot of different kinds of people from all the friendly libraries, because we hadn't really defined yet who was members, the sort of technology planning and the unbelievably bureaucratic organizational planning, which I'll talk more about in a moment. One step at a time, you know, we filed for incorporation. We got pro bono legal help. Should we be under the wing of another organization or should we be independent? So you had to work through these steps, which I have another slide about. And it takes a while. For instance, we got caught in the delays during the Obama administration in the approval of, it was on the end of the Bush administration and the beginning of the Obama administration, where there was some kind of scandal about people applying for 501c3 status, and I think it was one of the Midwest IRS offices was sort of squashing them all because somebody had, you know, politically loaded words in their description of their organization. Anyway, all these things are very time consuming. But it really came into being around about 2014, after we got incorporated and had bylaws and were able to go back to the Mellon Foundation and say, look at, you know, we've actually, and we had raised money internally, but we didn't have enough money to develop the portal. So the portal then came. So it's been a 10-year arc that I'll go into now more detail. So as I said, it is everybody you ever heard of in Chicago. The governing members started out as 12 or 13. Now, to be a governing member depends on how much dues you're willing to pay. But at the beginning, it was all the big universities and the public library and the Newberry and the Field Museum and the Art Institute of Chicago. The Chicago History Museum, the Center for Research Libraries came in a little later. But it was everybody with good collections about Chicago. And it was an immediate instinct that, yes, we need to do this. As we worked through how to be an organization and categories of membership and budget, we also developed a category for affiliate members. And also, once they saw, you know, who were the governing members, it was like, well, okay, you know, we have to be in it too. So we started getting a lot of the smaller organizations and participating and associate members, including some really cool places, like, who knew, the Alliance Française wanted to be a member. It turns out they have great archives. The Brookfield Zoo has cool archives. The Experimental Sound Studio has sound archives. And really the only criterion is that you have to be willing to make your collections accessible. And that can be done many ways. An institution does not have to have a public reading room. They don't have to have public hours. But if they are willing to take a phone call from a researcher and make an appointment for that person to come and look at the material, or if they're willing to make digital provision of the material. We're holding out a category for, I forget what the name is, but basically corporations in Chicago, and a for-profit corporation by governance and IRS rules cannot be in the same organization as nonprofit corporations. So you create a sort of a partnership category. And we are, you know, lusting after the archives of some incredible corporations in Chicago. The McDonald's Corporation, which is originally founded in Chicago, has its own archival operation with at least 5 employees in it. We are dying to know what's under the bleachers at Wrigley Field. We don't think they've ever shared their papers. The architecture firm Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill gave huge amounts of material to the Chicago History Museum over the years, but we know they have more. So we're also looking at how to make this history not limited to any one type of institution. Where is it, and how can we encourage participation as widely as possible? This takes a lot of money, and the dues fund, like our executive director, but then almost everything else takes a lot of extra philanthropic support, building the portal, a lot of software development, running public programs. And we're still in the early days as to what will be the budget models going forward. But we're very grateful, particularly to all the places that we list here, for really appreciating the vision. What is the vision? And then the fact that we could say, and here's the organizations that have already put their money on the table, is very compelling to funders. Early on, this is what was motivating us. Core goals, the most important thing was saving primary sources. Around about the time we all came together, the Jane Addams Hull House Museum was closed down. It's like, oh my God, what is going to happen to all those papers? Now, it turns out, actually, the papers already were on their way to University of Illinois at Chicago. But there's a lot of at-risk material. There are a lot of small neighborhood collections in various pockets of Chicago neighborhoods where there's not a lot of money, but there's a lot of history. And either current small neighborhood organizations or the remains of earlier organizations. And so how to protect at-risk material through a collaborative project. Like if that small neighborhood historical site can't preserve its own thing, can we collaborate and use the facilities at Northwestern through a small pass-through grant program, for example? This is obviously the major driver. Why do you want to preserve all this material? You want to facilitate scholarship. Whether it's the general public or the people who are on our own faculties, students, people in the city government, anybody, basically, it's open to anybody. And one of the faculty members who wrote one of our letters of support when we applied for the first Mellon Foundation grant was Carl Smith, who's written several books on the history of Chicago. Carl wrote this very compelling letter that said, if this portal had existed when I was doing my research, it would have shaved 2 years off my research time. And that means a lot to a foundation that cares about getting more scholarly work out to the public. This is the part of our work that's only starting to evolve now because we've had to build all this infrastructure first. But ultimately, we want to have a lot of programmatic services, K through 12 education, public events, more exhibitions. And we've just started doing that now. So we've had to sort of prioritize how do we see layers of services coming together through collaboration. These are some other things we've talked about, but we've really only so far done shared web access. But we've talked about what if we do a joint digital image project? What if we collaborate on storage facilities? Because many of us in the area have some of kind of different kinds, and some people have none. And so what's a way? So those things haven't, those smaller gears haven't happened yet. But it's all, this is the clever metaphor of the gears, it's driven by the big gear. So the building of a new organization is very hard, and it took an awful lot of meetings. And a lot of what the planning grant helps pay for is refreshments. Because if you keep insisting on having librarians from all over town, you know, 50, 60 people coming on their own time, because the grant was not paying for our time. But the grant paid for refreshments and consultants. And we had both technology consultants and organizational planning consultants. And lots of big meetings with lots of whiteboards. So it's tedious, and it's sort of like, you know, a marriage. You gotta work through because you have a common vision of why this is good, even though there was a lot of disagreements. What is the mission? What is going to be the technology? Is it going to be a shared repository? Are we going to make a big central pot, or are we going to have a federated pot? What's that going to look like? The hard things to work through early on are these kinds of seemingly tedious, but are crucial. And one of the very first things we had to do was define Chicago, define the region. What does Chicago Collections mean? And what if an organization is located in Chicago, but its mission is not collecting the history of Chicago in any way? We decided, no, that's not what we mean. You could actually have the University of Minnesota might have some incredible collections about Chicago, and they might want to join maybe at a lower level of membership because they can't come to all the meetings. So we decided it's all about people who have materials related to the history of Chicago, even if those materials also span additional subjects. And one of the things I'll point out when we get to our portal is there's a whole lot of subject coverage of things you would never have had any idea had to do with Chicago, but for example, the Nelson Algren papers, and all of a sudden you're looking at, you know, Simone de Beauvoir letters and things like that. So defining Chicago, defining whether we wanted to be our own organization or an affiliate underneath the wing of one of the universities. And we spent a lot of time looking around the country at what did other people do. And it's quite interesting when you really pull back the curtains on some of the consortia that we know and love. They're not what you might think. For instance, a Ahati Trust, another one that many of us helped build, is a wholly owned organization legally of the University of Michigan. It's not an independent. And then you can be semi-independent. You can be incorporated, but piggyback on somebody else's 501c3 status. And you can have lots of sort of operating MOUs for services. We decided to go whole hog, incorporate, and seek our own independent 501c3 status. But it takes a little while, and in the meantime, you sort of gain partnership oversight from the other institutions. You have to really prioritize your first projects to know what to pay for. We started out with only a half-time executive director, and now it's actually for a couple years been full-time. What's going to be the balance of dues or grants or fees? What kind of board, officers, bylaws, committees? All of this has to come from scratch. Many of us are used to being in organizations that have all of this infrastructure, and you think you know how it works until you have to invent it de novo. And we were very lucky, for example, many of us, because we were all in the same city and we had often overlapping philanthropic boards. So through some of our donor boards, we reached out to some retired attorneys who were very expert in nonprofit organizations, wealth management, helped us walk through the bylaws process, some of the philanthropic funding models, some of the ways to approach wealthy people in town. And so we were greatly benefited by just long-time existing city-municipal relationships. We early on, as I said, wanted a very flexible membership. So you don't have to really look at this matrix, but these are all the categories of membership and sort of what you get at different categories. And this is very helpful because there are as many organizations, we have I think 25 members now, everybody has a slightly different set of preferences. Well, I want to be part of this thing, but not that thing. And so obviously we can't be completely customizable. So what is the core needs that we want as an organization that we need funding for? And then what are some of the optional or add-ons? It'll probably be the case that the web portal, once the grant funding for that is terminated, will be a fee for service where if you don't have material ingested in the portal, you're not paying for it, and it's free to search. So the fees might just go if your organization is loading finding aids and images into the portal. The core dues have to support the operations of the organization, the board and the executive director. Things like exhibitions, we're trying to view as grant-funded, each one its own particular project, because those are very hard to predict in terms of the cost, in terms of the timing. And a ton of committees. And I have to say, the great thing about doing something like this with a lot of libraries is everybody is already used to being on a lot of committees. All of us were constantly volunteering up our staffs. Like, here's a list. We need people to volunteer to serve on the content committee, which was basically what evolved after, you know, the spreadsheet. The Cooperative Reference Network is a fairly new committee, because as soon as we put, even before we had a web portal, as soon as we put a spreadsheet online, we started getting questions at the website from random members of the, you know, web public. It's like, can you help me with my homework? Which was actually the nature of the questions. So the committees are crucial, and the committees are constantly evolving. And a lot of the work of an executive director is, of course, marshaling this organizational kind of amoeba shifting mass of people. As you all can imagine, now that we've been around for a couple of years, we're looking at assessment. That was not one of the first committees, but of course we have it now. And strategic planning, which we didn't do until we were an organization. It's like, well, what do we need to plan? We're not even a thing yet. But our very first executive director, who was actually a paid staffer, came in, and it, many of us thought, isn't this premature? Isn't this sort of a bureaucratic luxury? We don't have anything to plan yet. But in fact, it turns out to be crucial, because when you don't have very much money and you have really big ideas, the strategic plan is the only way you can decide what's going to come first. And we struggled greatly with lots of focus groups and surveys and more committee meetings, but key was having a really single vision executive director who was going to herd the cats. Meanwhile, we were also working on the technology product and trying to launch the organization itself with another collaborative exhibit. We hadn't had one since 2006 on the Festival of Maps. And we started thinking, okay, are we going to do a decentralized exhibit, a centralized exhibit? Turns out there's a lot of negotiations that have to go on with insurance and different buildings and the requirements of host institutions. And we did actually manage to have a great exhibition that got a huge amount of press coverage downtown in the main building of the Chicago Public Library, the Harold Washington Library Center, where we had, of course, a big reception and a wonderful, inspirational historian as a speaker. And this really put us on the map in terms of Chicago itself being aware that this was happening. And it was a centralized exhibit with mishmash from all the different partners. No particular theme, just literally raw material, the stuff of history. And really things you don't expect, like the Chicago Public Library is a city agency. If they have things on exhibit in their building, private universities like me have to fill out the forms determined by the city agency. And then I have to go to our general counsel and say, is it okay for me to sign off on this insurance agreement with this city agency that we don't normally do this kind of business with them? So there's a kind of a running level of how do you cut across institutions with very different types of governance. But it's doable. It's very doable. The exhibition was very popular. We had inaugural speaker series. Then, a couple of months after the exhibit, came really our big prize, the web portal itself. This is live now. You can look up explorechicagocollections.org. And it works works better on a laptop, although we show a nice image of someone looking at it on a mobile phone. But you have a big images and multiple window views that you can have open. So it works a little bit better when you have more real estate, more screen real estate. I won't do any live demos right while I'm speaking, but it's not that hard to get in and show you some very clever things. We also retained a consulting firm for graphic design. In addition to the technology design itself, you know, it has to look good. So this went through several iterations. You know, we had some freebie graphic design from one of the member libraries that there was a lot of complaints about, so we moved away from that. We hired a professional design firm. They did lots more focus groups, and that took lots more money. But we came up with a really great, we're very happy with the design. And it had to work for everybody because the audience is not limited to the constituencies of a given member institution. So it's not limited to university students and faculty. It's not limited to the public library. It's not limited to the municipal agencies. It has to work for everybody. And that's, of course, what we think is its glory. And we really wanted to link all this content, initially not be a repository, but be a linker of all of this information. And the problem is we didn't you know, all this stuff is sitting in people's different digital catalogs, cataloged in different ways, or partly cataloged or not cataloged, and different cataloging rules. And how can we harvest all this information without making people redo anything? Because again, it comes back to the governance. And so the Chicago Public Library head of technical services is like, well, these are the rules we use, and this is it. You know, in Northwestern, my catalogers are saying, you know, this is what we do. We're not redoing those finding aids. So we had to find a way to put a layer of searchability across enormously varying materials. We didn't think people would join the consortium if they had to redo their digital collections. And everybody was very excited about seeing their materials integrated into a portal. And to do that integration means, you know, this hugely different array of subject categories. Everybody's cataloging different things. If you put in some term, it might pull up only one object when we know, in fact, there's tens of thousands of things in there. So we spent a lot of effort looking at how to integrate the materials. And we looked at a lot of different commercial software. We looked at whether we should write our own or a little bit of both. What is possible? What's affordable? What do people already use in their institutions? This was very contentious. I would say this was very difficult, and we had some real head-butting between some of the real technical experts and some of the leaders, because people were sort of going off on different angles. You should do it like this, and we're saying, well, that wasn't the good idea. So this took a while, and over the couple of years that we were working on this, of course, a couple of software things went belly up. That company doesn't exist anymore. That open source solution has gone away. What are we going to do? And then there's interesting issues about people's legal ability to deposit material. They have it. They can show it to their patrons. Can they share it with anybody else? Can they host it elsewhere? What are people's rights? And sometimes that's a matter of the object, and sometimes that's a matter of the depositing of the object into a hosted system of some kind. So really it's two pieces. I'm going to skip over this technical stuff very briefly, and I'm happy to talk more about it later, or more likely refer you to our portal manager, which is another full-time position we now have, because I was much more involved in the bureaucratic side of the planning than the technical side of the planning. But basically, there's a wonderful search engine that sits on the front, and then something that's basically a metadata hopper, or what in the olden days we often referred to as crosswalking the metadata. How can you get different types of cataloging to map into more generalizable groups so that some very detailed cataloging is still searchable in large chunks? This was what the metadata hopper was, what we built ourselves with a lot of the Mellon grant, and it's an open source software that we can share with people. This again is the quickie version of it, in order to reassure archivists and catalogers that it really is very easy to sort of plug in your materials regardless of how they're described. Now, it doesn't automatically require that the image itself or the text itself also go in. So our goal was to link back to people's existing systems. If Northwestern or the University of Chicago's already got a huge repository full of images and text, we're not moving that material, we're just harvesting the cataloging data. Now, what if a small organization comes along that does not have a big repository? We do envision a future where we might offer repository services to a smaller place now that we have this very robust portal system. You can search, and these colored bars are the hoppers, if you will. You can search by events, by daily life, by places, neighborhood names. You can search thematically. You can also put in a very concrete search term. It's a little hard to see. The print is a little pale on this screen, but you get sort of facets by types of images. the search word put in was convention, and you're getting everything from, you know, political conventions. Obviously, we're very obsessed right now about the 1968 convention coming up on the 50th anniversary. Should that be the theme for our next shared exhibit, for example? When you get the results of a given object, it goes into detail and then links you to that object back at the home organization. I think my slide got a little out of order there. Sorry for that. This is really what I was saying initially, that you can search by these different themes. And when you get the actual record, this is an actual record for a specific set of papers, and it tells you where it is, how much it is. It may or may not have the full set of images that go with that, but then you know where it is. And that was really what we didn't know before. We didn't have a way to know what each other had. and this has just been a radical transformation in the connectivity across resources in Chicago. The finding aids is the minimum metadata records, and there actually are a lot of images. So over, it's now more than 12 months, this slide was done in January. Everybody in the globe is using this because it's easy to find online and it's easy to use. And it's fairly lightweight because you're not searching directly into the whole repository. You're searching into this cataloging layer and then linking back out to other universities or the public library or the experimental sound archive. We've started now the next step, the collaborative reference network. We're interested in, we have to get some funding, but we very much want to do some K-12 instructional materials. We're now partnering with the History Fair, the Chicago Metro History Fair, because we have a lot of kids really wanting, this is like an ideal resource for K-12 kids working on history projects. We've had some roundtables with faculty. That's what the researcher roundtables is. We're trying to ask at different levels, how do you use this kind of material? What do you need? Do you want more functionality in the portal, or are you looking more at types of classroom instruction that we could help with? We've had some Wikipedia edit-a-thons. We're part of the Digital Public Library of America. We're taking our links out to the next steps, if you will, beyond that. And as I said, we're thinking about the next joint exhibition, something to do with the 50th anniversary of 1968. Although it turns out the copyright's a killer for stuff around the era of 1968. We'll probably broaden the theme to be about protest in Chicago with some 1968 focus and more maybe older focus on more materials. The one thing that's especially difficult for the 1968 era is getting any music rights. So if we want audio streaming in a digital exhibit, could be very difficult. But this has not happened yet. We are looking for curatorial work right now to pull this together over the course of the coming year. As I said, looking now also for special funding for K-12, and several of our curators, there was so much publicity around the exhibit that we've had radio interviews. There is actually an ongoing sort of, you know, ask a question kind of show on WBEZ, Curious City, and they've interviewed several of our folks on clever topics, which has again been sort of a secondary wonderful PR benefit. And this was actually someone from Northwestern who was interviewed on the radio about what happened to the supposed Zeppelins of Chicago, which never went anywhere. So we've had a huge amount of media coverage. Some of you librarians in the audience may have seen there was a nice article quite recently in American Libraries about this. We've had several presentations at conferences. We were quite pleased that Inside Higher Education which goes to a huge array of academic institutions, picked up on this when they were talking about a new library collaboration in Georgia. And they said, well, maybe it'll be like the Chicago Collections Consortium. So in a fairly short amount of years, this has just become a very definitive and assumed that it's going to continue organization. So we're now looking at what are the next priorities? How do we move beyond that? Our fantastic founding executive director, our family moved, so we had to hire a new executive director. We didn't think it was possible to be as good as the first person. We've hired someone who we think is going to be even more fantastic. So a certain critical mass has evolved, and the assumptions among all of our institutions are that this is now intrinsic to our work. There's incredibly powerful outcomes for looking at municipal cultural heritage in a system like this. As I said at the beginning, a lot of this material is old, and these organizations are old, but the stuff has not been connected. And it's the advent of the digital that has helped us connect and leverage all this incredible archival material. We're really focusing primarily on archival, but in some institutions that might be published or monographic material if it's part of an aggregation that relates to the history of Chicago. So the real focus is on what I might call distinctive materials. And many of these things the public was unaware of or did not think they were allowed to use. So the sort of goodness impact is incredible of people realizing what's out there. And the portal allows us both to improve access and to improve the preservation, as we know, because a lot of people are happy with what they get digitally, especially kids doing school projects. They do not have to come in the archives and handle at-risk materials. On the other hand, scholars doing advanced research who are perfectly aware and knowledgeable about handling fragile materials never knew that was there before and now know which archive has the letters of so-and-so. I have to find out the rest of that anecdote, but I think it was so embarrassing to the two institutions involved that they wanted to hush up who was the correspondence. We've also realized in recent years the only way something like this could be done is collaboratively. You can't have one institution responsible for the history of the city, and you can't have one institution afford doing a big project like this. And the regionalism is a huge advantage. So at a city like St. Louis, where you have similar cultural heritage institutions and pride in the region's history, this is really an amazing model that you might think about in your area. We're always happy to help. We benefited greatly from friends all over the country giving us advice and help. We've got lots of social media. We're always happy to visit and talk. And actually, as I said, we can share code. And I will stop there and take any questions that you have. Thank you. Surely, yes.
Sarah, one thing this makes, it reminds me of so many things I worked on, and it makes me glad I'm retired. Because I know how much hard work it is. This is a really exciting development in the sort of use of technology for the democratization of intellectual life.
Exactly.
Somebody like myself who grew up in the middle of nowhere really appreciates this. Are you finding that you're being called upon, you and other people involved, to do a roadshow to sell this beyond Philadelphia and Chicago?
Well, we're starting to get into that. Initially, we were trying to do presentations just to get the word out in Chicago. So we went to the Illinois Library Association and things like that. But yes, I think this event, we've been asked to talk a couple of the other board members. The board members, you know, there's 12 or 15 board members from every institution in Chicago. So everybody is kind of an evangelist for the organization. And the multi-type collaboration is far more venturesome than even I, as a active multi-type librarian, thought could be possible, that we could actually work across very different types of organizations with different types of funding and trustees and bosses and legal entities, and yet by defining a certain sort of surface layer of the collaborative layer, then people still control their objects, their facilities, their user policies, but it's that connecting layer that's unique and that's been made possible by the technology, and also, frankly, by people's practicality. This was all happening over the years of the huge financial crash, which is another miracle. Well, you know, we started in 2006, everybody's budget tanks in 2009, and we never lost a step. I mean, it would have taken this long even in a year or two of very rich funding, because the forging of the bureaucratic agreements and making the kinds of technological decisions that we had to do, it's just no way around the time-consuming and endless meetings that go into that. But we're all a little tired, so I'm sure we will take it on the road, especially as we are, you know, continuing to look for more funding and expansion of membership. We have a long list of people we would love to have as members still within the region of Chicago, let alone elsewhere. And we're still, you know, looking at that. We've already had one member drop out because of the financial crash, and we don't want that to happen. So we're looking at, can we have emergency funds or special reserves to help out a small institution that can't afford even, say, $500 to be an affiliate. Yes?
Have you found that collaboration on the sense of identity that's penetrated beyond just the sharing of archives and really changed the institutions in a sense where they are looking at themselves as collaborators or in various ways?
A teeny, teeny bit. That is, has this collaboration really changed the institutional identity at a larger level? Not everybody all at once. It has made a lot of subsidiary individual things easier. For instance, Northwestern negotiated a contract with the Art Institute for them to use our shared storage facility, and not shared, our offsite storage facility. And I think the fact that I had gotten to know the library director at the Art Institute so much better over the course of this project helped, even though the project itself wasn't saying, oh, let's all do a single storage facility. So I think it's going in that direction. I think there's still a lot of just logistical barriers to bringing that many organizations of different types together. But I think, you know, yes, to the degree that we now have a new default. The first thing we can say to each other is, should we do this through Chicago Collections, or is that too complicated? Let's revert to a small, you know, let's just a couple of us work on this. And also, each of us is a continuing member of other organizations, so I can't say to the whole membership of the Chicago Collections, let's all do this ARL project, because ARL has its own membership, and I can't graft the CCC onto that. So there's still some collaborative difficulties, but this has certainly opened a lot of doors, and the PR has been so good that most of our presidents are really proud, even if they didn't have anything to do with it. All the money except the grants, all the money came from the library's own budgets. So, yes, woman. Right.
This may seem very simplistic, but from a user perspective, from your constituent members, have you seen the validation and the valuation of this project in the eyes of the constituent students, for example, across institutions?
That's what we're just starting to look at with our assessment committee. Anecdotally, yes, we have a lot of anecdotal feedback from, you know, just email or people who leave a question at the website, or people who contact the Cooperative Reference Network, where we farm questions out to each other as questions come into one place, and then we send them around. So we are getting very positive feedback, you know, informally, eclectically. But that's exactly why we want to undertake a more systematic assessment now of how people are using it, who's using it. When they have difficulty, is it difficulty related to the search tool, the interface, or is it because the materials just aren't there? So there's a lot of questions we have about how well it's working that we don't have answers to yet. We think it's working well. There was a question in the corner, yeah.
So I guess you said not all members are required to deposit digital objects or digitized objects to take part. So my question is how does CCC sort of interfaces with portals of digital collections that's emerging right now, or those like the Digital Public Library of America?
Well, we are sharing our data with the Digital Public Library of America, and we host DPLA-a-thon that's going to be in Chicago. So we are trying to collaborate very closely with the DPLA, but ultimately the actual deposit comes from our members. So we ourselves are not a separate repository, but we can then encourage coordinated deposit into the DPLA or harvesting of metadata. So our goal is the integration comes at the individual member level, not through our own portal. I know that sounds a little convoluted, but we can't just harvest the harvesting. We can't take all of the top layer of our data and send it somewhere else. It has to come from the members who own the data.
On that note, please join me in thanking Dean Pritchard for a very thought-provoking presentation.
Thank you.